people, and understanding. Show where we take you, the viewer, through all the ins and outs of your home computer. Now, in today's episode, we're going to be continuing our series on the internet. We're going to be showing you websites and also email. I'm Rob Farr.
And I'm Sean Bankey. In the previous episode, we show you how to actually use the dial-up network and connect to an internet service provider. Now, what we're going to be showing you now is the different software needed to actually, what's called browsing the web. Now, what I've done is I saved ourselves the trouble and it's actually already connected to my internet service provider by using my dial-up network. Now, I'm going to load up my internet browser. Now, as I mentioned before, there are many different types. There are ones that do come with Windows 95, as well as one third-party ones you can get. The one that we'll be using this time around is Netscape Communicator. Now, what I've done here is I've actually set up a shortcut, so I'm going to access it right from my desktop. And what it's going to do here is, because I've already connected to my internet service provider, it's going to take me to whatever I have, whatever page I have set up. Now, in the preferences for this one, the thing with an internet service, with an internet browser, excuse me, is it's very customizable. Same with Windows 95. Now, this one, we've had it set up to, it comes up to a blank page. Now, what you see here is the basic layout of any internet browser. What you would have up here is your standard menus, your file, edit, view, as well as whatever other menus are needed for the actual program. You'll have another set of icons that will guide you through or take you through each time that you go to a different site or a different page, as well as a command line interface for typing in certain commands or certain websites. As well as some of them will have different shortcuts or icons in the bottom right-hand corner. Now, for instance, what we're going to be doing here in our command line interface, besides where it says location, this is where you can type in different sites to go. But say, for instance, you're not exactly sure where you would want to go on the internet. Now, the internet itself is a collaboration of different networks that are tied into each other. When you're hopping from one place to another, what you're doing is you're hopping from one computer network or one server to another, connecting you to the destination computer that you want to go that has the information. Now, if I knew the actual address where I wanted to go, I could simply type it in, and what it will do is it will take me there. Now, if I didn't know where I want to go, or I want to look up a specific title for information, what I would use is an internet search engine or an internet search listing. Now, the one that I know off the top of my head happens to be Yahoo, and I'm just going to simply type that in now. Now, all I've done is I typed in my www, which stands for World Wide Web, .yahoo.com. Now, the extension .com assumes for a company. And when I do that, I'll hit my enter, and down near the bottom of the screen, it will tell me that it's connected, it has found the specific site that I'm looking for, and has brought it up, as you can see here.
Now, there's a difference between an internet search listing and an internet search engine. Now, a listing will only post websites that are given to it. What happens is say, I wanted to put a website up on the internet. Well, I finish my website, I post it, but I want a lot of people to come see my website. So I go to a place like Yahoo and I say, look, I have a website, could you please add it to your listing? What happens is that Yahoo, or the listing service, will go out and it'll look at my website. Now, if it thinks my website is good enough to be on their listing, it'll add my website into whatever category is found on that particular listing service. Now, a search engine works differently. What it does is it goes out and it actively searches all the worldwide websites that contain, and what it does is it makes a database of all the words that are used in those websites. Now, say if I go into a search engine and I type in a specific topic like hockey, what'll happen is it'll go out, it'll find every website on the web that has hockey in it, either in the main title or somewhere in the website. Now, you'll get a lot more hits using a search engine, but you'll also get a lot of sites that you don't really need that are sometimes completely irrelevant to what you're looking for.
Okay, as Rob was mentioning, if I want to define something particular, now the main purpose that a lot of people using it for is for schoolwork or trying to find out for something in a book report or whatever. Other times people simply go on and they want to find different software that they want to add to the computer, use their Windows 90, for the Windows 95 operating system, or whatever operating system they're using. Now, for instance, say you have a son or daughter that's looking for a project on Pluto. Well, what we're simply going to do here is simply type Pluto. Now, as Rob mentioned, what it's going to do is going to search listings for people or for sites that have the words or terms Pluto. Now, as you can see here, it has come up and it has found four categories based on the input Pluto. And it has come up with 163 site matches or hits for Pluto. Now, the main one that we're after, of course, the planet Pluto. And it happens to be the first one, which is in science, astronomy, solar system, planets, Pluto. And Pluto is normally underlined in a with bold. In this particular case, we have been here before, so the site, the link itself here, it has been shaded out, but we can still access it. As you can see, my pointer changes from an arrow to a finger. Now, I'm just going to scroll down here and show you other things. Now, because I didn't really give it any particular definition of what I was looking for in Pluto, it gave me other sites or other places that have Pluto in it. For instance, the other link underneath it for Pluto happens to be under comics, animation, and it happens to be a character in an animation series called Sailor Moon. In other ones, there's also, as you can see here, it's found out in plutonium, all right? It's taken the section for plutonium and it's come out with that. And there are many other words. You can simply scroll down. And as mentioned before, there were 163 different ones. But the main one we wanted to go to was the planet Pluto. So we're going to simply select that. And it's going to take me to my next page. Now, as I mentioned before, with different, when you go from page to page, the different icons up at the top here. Now, if you notice, I can now select back, reload, home. Now what this is, if I say I want to go back, say I want to go back to that next page that I wasn't, you know, there was something on there that I missed or I want to look up again, I can simply hit that, go back, and it will reload the last page that I was on. Now the reason it reloaded it so fast is because it puts it in a cache. It puts it the information in a folder that is located on your hard drive. Now each internet browser will have its own designation or its own cache, and what this does is if you go to a particular site over and over again, this drastically improves the amount of time it takes to load the information off. Now say you were to jump from one site to another back and forth that you haven't been to before, the time it takes to actually connect to that server, download the information, does take a while depending on what's all on there. Now, if you went to the same site again, it doesn't take as long because it already has bits of that information stored on your computer in its cache. Now, continuing along here, now that I've gone forward to where I was last, there's different titles or different sections, links that I can take to that will take me to Pluto. For instance, the one that I want to go to will take Pluto NASA. And what this is going to do is it's going to connect that link to wherever it is going to. Now this may take a bit of time depending on how busy that actual server is. The one thing people get misunderstood with is you may have a very fast computer, but your computer doesn't necessarily control how fast you access the internet. There is a bit of percentage involved in there, but the thing is your main dependence on is how you're connected. There's different ways you can connect to the internet, but with a standard modem, It's all dependent on the phone line and how far away the server is. It's not necessarily if you have the fastest computer with a large amount of RAM. You particularly have no control over how fast the information is downloaded, unless, of course, you're using the different technology it is for the internet. Now, as you can see here, I've gone to, the link has taken me to the next site that I want for my Pluto, and it will simply load this information up on my screen. Now, say I wanted to print this information out. Well, again, up at your top where your menu is, you can go to print. Now, as long as you have a printer connected to your computer, that's all you do. You select print. It will ask you if you want all pages or individual pages. You can set that up to whatever you want. Now, if I want to save this particular page for future reference, and I don't want to go through the hassle of loading up my search engine, what I can do is create a bookmark. Now, all a bookmark is simply putting a file in my browser so it knows exactly where to go next time I load up my internet browser. Now, I can simply do this by going to bookmarks, and it will bring up a menu asking me to add bookmark, file a bookmark, and edit a bookmark. What I want to do is simply add a bookmark. So once I set add bookmark, what it's going to do is take the address that is in my command line interface here and simply add it to my bookmark. Now, as you can see here in my menu, it does have what's called Pluto, because that was the actual name, the actual search that I gave it to. So now if I simply went back to my search engine here, and I went to bookmarks, I can select bookmark Pluto, and it will take me right back to that particular site. Now, you can do that by next time you log on to your internet service provider. That will always be there until you actually remove it. Now we're going to go back to another one. Now, as I mentioned before, if you know the particular company name or file that you're looking for, you can type it in your Yahoo command line interface. Now, another example. I know this particular magazine's out there called PC Gamer. Now, what I'm going to do is simply type in PC Gamer, because that is the name of the magazine. And what I'll do again is it will search its listing for PC Gamer, and it's come up with, as you notice here, because it's a very select subject that I was looking for, it only came up with three site matches for PC Gamer, and it happens to be the one that I'm looking for. When you type it in, it will, the odd time, it may not give you the exact internet address, but in this case, it actually gave me the complete internet or website address, which happens to be www.pcgamer.com. Now, I can select this link, and what it will do is will contact the server for PC Gamer and simply load it up. Now, again, because I haven't actually been on here, it does take a bit longer. Down at the bottom, it will give you a brief indication of what it's downloading, how big the file is, and sometimes how long it will take to download it. Now, in this particular case, there wasn't that much on there that took long to download, and it came up. Now, again, if I wanted to, I can simply add that to my bookmarks, and I won't have to worry about typing that in again. Now, the other thing with an internet browser, you know, that this is the main part of an internet browser. Now, you can also, there's also other features built into internet browsers that you can use, such as you can use the built-in browser email, and you can also use the built-in browser news groups. But we'll get into that later, a little later on. After the break, we'll deep into that even further, with getting into the email as well as third-party programs for using email and news groups.
CPU is sponsored by BT Video Productions and Computers, located at 140 Highway Street in Petawawa. Phone 687 687- 5198.
Welcome back. Well, in the first half of the show, we showed you the World Wide Web. Now we'll show you probably the most popular part of the internet, and that's email. Now, email is short for electronic mail, and it's fast becoming the new way to send messages between people over long distances. It's estimated that the internet in one day handles more mail than Canada Post handles in one year. Now, how do you get to use your email? Well, first, of course, you have to have an account with an internet service provider. Now, your username and your internet address forms your email address. Now, you put this into an email program and you have capabilities of sending and receiving email. Now, we have an email program running right now, and it's called Pegasus. Now, there's many different types of email programs out there, and like Sean had mentioned before the break, many web browsers also come with email built into them. Now, quite often, these email packages aren't quite as robust as the dedicated email packages are. What we're going to show you right now is Pegasus Mail. Now, Pegasus, like I said, is a dedicated email package. You can do many different things with it here. You notice along here we have a menu bar. You can compose new messages. You can open your mail folders and even work with your mail folders as well. You have what's called an address book, which is quite often the same as your address book in the real world. You have mailing lists as well, if in case you have, say, one message that you want to send over across to, say, 20 or 30 people, but you don't want to have to sit there and type in their mailing address, or 30 people's mailing address into this one message. You can create a list and send the message at the same time to everybody at once. Now, you can open a list of local people on your system, create rules for filtering your mail with this particular program. You can browse what's called notice boards. You have your basic cut and paste functions, saving to diskette and copying to diskette. You have your basic printing functions. And down here, these three buttons here are probably the most important ones, where you receive your mail from the internet, you send your mail, or you can do both at the same time. Say if you have a lot of mail to send, you can send it all at once, do all your typing offline, connect up to the internet, and then send the mail all at once. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to compose a letter to ourselves. We're going to send a letter back to ourselves just to show you how quickly email can travel. Now, quite often, say you're writing to somebody in Hong Kong. You upload the, you write your message, you send it out over the internet, and the average time is anywhere for between 15 minutes to half an hour, and that person in Hong Kong, if of course they're on the internet, would be able to download their message. Now, of course, if they're not on the net at the time, it would simply wait in what's called your mailbox or in your account until that person logs on and gets their mail. Now, we're just going to compose a new mail message here. We click on that button. Now, the message here, we have to, okay, which is the person that we're sending it to. The subject that we're going to, that the mail is going to have, and CC. Now, CC is short for carbon copy. If we want to send this on to more people, we would put their email addresses in here. Now, over here at the far side, you'll notice we have a question mark. Now, this question mark gives us a listing of all the people that we've recently sent email to. Now, unfortunately, the email address that we're looking for isn't in this listing. So what we'll do is we'll close this out, and we'll type in the email address. Okay, that's my username, and then I have an at symbol. Now, what this is saying is that you have this username at this server. And the server name and address comes after, of course, your username. And in this case, it's fox.nstn.ca. Oh. And of course, you always have to remember to spell it correctly, otherwise it won't be delivered. And also, quite often, email addresses are case sensitive. if there's an uppercase in it, then you have to have that particular letter in uppercase. Most times, it's all in lowercase. So we'll, that's our address. We'll put in a subject, CPU, and then we'll just put in the body of our message. This is a test message. All right, now we've finished writing it, and we're going to send it now. And we have a button right here that says send. So we'll click on that. That connects up to the internet. And we'll just send it out right by clicking on this button right here. Actually, it queued it up in this particular program. It saves it as a queue, and now we'll send the message out to the internet. Right now it says it's verifying any user details that we have. It's connecting up, and it's sent the message, and it's gone now. Now the internet or email uses several different types of protocols to send your mail. One of these particular types of protocols is SMTP, or Simple Mail Transfer Protocol. This is one of the rules that the internet uses, or sets of rules that the internet uses to transfer mail. The next is POP, or Post Office Protocol. Again, this is another set of rules that is that governs the server that your mail resides on. And now you have the final one, MIME, or M-I-M-E, short for Multipurpose Internet Mail Extensions, which is another set of rules, again, to send rules for sending mail over the internet. Now, as well as sending mail, you can also send small files over the internet. And then you do that by what's called an attachment. An attachment is basically you're attaching a file to your email. Quite often you can send anywhere upwards of a 10 megabyte file if you'd like, but your internet service provider quite often doesn't like that because it's what's called mail bombing. What you do is you send a very large file and it takes forever for the other person to download, which ties up server time. Well, our mail message should be able to get back to us now. What we're going to do is we're going to check the internet now for the mail. So we click on this button here. It's connecting up. It's getting our message list, and it's downloading 24 messages. I have quite a bit of mail. It's been a while since I've gotten on, but I do have quite a bit of mail waiting for me. Thankfully, it's small messages. Now, when this comes up, you'll probably only see one or two messages on the screen that we're going to be bringing up. What I have my browser doing is actually sorting out the mail into different folders for me. So say if I get a message from my mother, it's not going to be sorted in with everything else, say messages from colleagues of mine that are looking for help with their computer problems. You can do this in this particular program and in other programs as well. All right, my email's almost done here. And it's come up now with the window for the mail that I've received. Now, there are three messages here that don't fall into any of the filtering that I've set up on this mail. And the first one is the message that I sent to myself here. So I'll just double click on the message, and it brings it up. This is a test message, and that's exactly what I sent to myself. And you notice that only took a couple of minutes.
That's all the time we have for today's episode. Before we leave, we'll be leaving you a list of some of the more popular websites on the internet today. For CPU, I'm Sean Banky.
I'm Rob Farr. Have a great day.